It is the appointed time for the meeting and we have a quorum. I call to order the meeting. Item 1, confirmation of minutes of meeting. The meeting of the minutes of the last meeting have been sent to members and the clerk has not received any proposals for amendment. Can I ask members to confirm the minutes, please? Any objection? No objection. The minutes are confirmed. Item 2, information papers issued since the last meeting. Number 1, letter from Alice MAK dated the 28th of October. Anything to say on that, members? And number 2, letter dated the 2nd of November from Mr. Charles MOK. Any views on that, members? Number 3, letter dated the 10th of November from Nathan Law and the clerk's reply. Any views on that? Okay, if not, the 4th one, letter dated the 16th of November from Starry Lee. Would anyone like to say anything? Okay, thank you. Item 3 on the agenda. Items for discussion at the next meeting. Now we'll invite the administration team to come in first. The next regular meeting will be held on the 19th of December, Monday at 2:30 in the afternoon. Members can refer to the list of outstanding items for discussion. The administration proposes to discuss these two items, one, review of objection mechanism in voter registration system, and two, regulation of the use of social media and the conduct of voting survey in public elections. We'd like to welcome Mr. Ronald Chan, Undersecretary for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs, Ms. Rosanna Law, DS for CMA, and Ms. Natalie Lee, Assistant Director of Film, Newspaper and Article Administration, Office of the Communications Authority. Undersecretary, can you walk us through the items proposed by the administration for the next meeting? Thank you, Chairman. We propose to take up two items at the meeting next time. One, review of objection mechanism in voter registration system. In the 2015 elector registration cycle, the public have raised concern. At the end of last year, we consulted the public on optimizing the registration system. And on the 21st of December, at a CAP meeting, we consulted the panel on the proposed measures. At the time, members generally supported that we should take measures to improve the voter registration system. After considering views collected from the consultation period, we released a consultation report on the 21st of January this year, and we also wrote out a number of measures to improve the system, including an objection mechanism. We'd like to take up this item next time. We will introduce to members the systems in overseas countries in handling objection from voters, and also we'd like to listen to members on your views on the proposed mechanism. The second item we are proposing is regulation of the use of social media and the conduct of voting surveys in public elections. The CAP spoke on the DCLC and the selection committee or election committee subsector elections, and many members spoke on the use of social media for releasing messages and election advertisements. And some members asked us to study the issue in overseas countries. And also, some members voiced concern about regulation of surveys done before election day. Because of this, we'd like to report to members the relevant regulation measures in overseas countries and to listen to members. Thank you. Any views from members, please? Mr. Leung Yu-chung, Chairman. Talking about election procedures, can I ask that you also look into the cooling off period during the procedure, especially on election day? Ms. Dari Lee wrote you a letter. Ms. Dari Lee wrote a letter. I believe the Bureau has got the letter. Maybe you should consider that letter as well. I'm asking you to also look into the cooling off period arrangement in other countries. The Undersecretary has already said yes. Okay, thank you. So that's it for the next meeting. One, review of the objection mechanism in voter registration systems, and two, regulation of the use of social media and the conduct of voting surveys in public elections. Item 4. Revision of fees under the Registration of Local Newspapers Ordinance. There are two papers which have been distributed to members. They are CB(2183)-16-17(03). This is from the administration. And also CB(2183)-16-17(04), the background brief prepared by the Legislative Council Secretariat. Undersecretary, please walk us through the paper from the administration, and then I will invite members to ask questions, please. Thank you, Chairman. Under the regulations of the Registration of Local Newspapers Ordinance, there are 11 items which are the subject of fee collection. These include registration of local newspaper, annual renewal of registration of local newspaper, change of particulars of local newspaper, search and inspection of register, and also certified extract from register, etc. The charging should be on the principle or on the basis of user pays, and there should be a regular review. In 2014, we conducted a review of the fees, and it showed that the cost recovery rates were 36% to 77%. In order to recover full cost in a gradual manner and not to implement a steep fee increase, we enhanced the fees by 10% to 20% at that time. This time around, we are seeing a cost recovery rate of 45% to 93%, and we propose to increase the fees according to existing guidelines. 7 fee items will be increased by 15% and 4 not more than 10%. The actual increase is $6 to $115. We believe this will have little impact on people's livelihood or daily lives and the operation of the businesses concerned. If members support us, we will come up with the amendment regulations for negative vetting next month, and we expect to implement the new fees at the end of March. Thank you. Members can now ask questions. 3 members, Pun Xiuping, Alvin Yeung, and Claudia Mo. 4 minutes each for the first round. I can allow a second round. Kwun Xiuping, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. The Undersecretary said that you would like to recover fees on the principle of user pays, and you would like to achieve full cost recovery gradually. Among the 11 fees, one will achieve 100% recovery. I'd like to ask you whether you have a timetable. You are increasing the fees by 10 to 15% on average. And it will take quite a long time before you can have full cost recovery. Do you have a timetable to achieve the target of 100%? Undersecretary. Thank you, Chairman. We don't have a timetable. But using the principle of user pays, our final objective is to recover all costs. But as I said, we'd like to avoid a steep fee increase. So we now conduct regular reviews and then we'll come up with fee revisions. We think that is more desirable, but the ultimate goal is to recover all costs. It's just that we don't have a specific timetable to achieve that. Mr. Pun Xiuping, any follow-up?
Well, no. In other words, it seems you do a review every 2 years.
In other words, after this time, you will review it 2 years later. But the difference is only a few dollars for some of the fees, and it will not have a big impact on the cost. I don't know how you evaluate the impact on the people.
Chairman, when we do the review next time, we will consider them all. Last time, it was 2004 when we had the review. 2014. But we don't have an actual timetable. As for when the next review will be done, and for the proposed fees later on, we don't have any decision at this point. But if members agree with today's revision of fees, next time we do the review, we will carefully consider all factors, including the impact on the public and the sector following previous rounds of fee revisions, and we'll see whether we should raise the fee further. In the next review, we'll definitely look into that. Alvin Young. Thank you, Chairman. On the fees, I'd like to ask the administration that I've noticed that indeed the fee items actually are really small, and for the operators, they may not pose much burden on them. So with the adjustment of the 11 fee items, the ratio of cost recovery varies widely. So from an administration perspective, I'd like to ask the Bureau, you know, the adjustment figures are really small, and even with the cost recovery rates concerned, they really mean nothing to the sector. So why don't you, you know, since the amounts involved are so small, so to avoid future administration costs and coming back to lecture again, so I'd like to ask the administration what you're going to do. Yes, mainly, as I just said, we will try to avoid implementing too many adjustments in one go. But I've taken on board members' views, and I think that the fees concerned, as you all agree, are actually quite small, and the rate of increase is pretty small either. So next time when we do the review, we will consider your views and take into consideration what you've said and try to reduce the frequencies of coming back to that call for your permission. Each time a fee is free, so we may go for a larger increase next time. Any follow-up question? Claudia Mo? Haven't seen, really, the amounts mentioned are really minimal. And it's only to add to the government's income by 92,000. It's really small. And you said that this will be a negative vetting approach. You said that things have been done this way all along. I'm very sensitive to negative vetting. You said that the license for publishers, and you want to recover the cost to 100%, which I totally understand, or, you know, 100% percentage for newspaper distributors. The increase ranges from $37 to $43, but they are really small amounts, you know, despite all the huge admin work that you have to do, and also not to mention the hassle of coming to Legco for approval. I know that you must follow the prescribed procedures, but the question is whether you actually, to me, you can just impose a flat rate like $10 each and without changed over the next decade. We don't have a free flow of information act nor archive act, so we're now having this basic items here only, so why don't we have a flat rate for them instead of coming back every 2 years, you know, causing so much trouble and it's a waste of time. Similar questions, Undersecretary?
Yes. The view was noted, and next time when we do the review, we will take into consideration the views. But just then, Ms. Mo mentioned flat rate. What we are having now are actually like flat rates. So next time, if people want to check on the register, the same rate will be charged. But Ms. Mo, please understand that costs will be adjusted as time goes. Sorry for interrupting. I think all these costs, you don't need to argue with me over that. Just ask me, our archive law and Freedom of Information Act, where are they? Sima Leung made promises on that, you know, but more than 4 years have passed and nothing has happened. If you don't give me an answer, I would like to ask you then. On this issue of cost recovery, how come in some cases it's 100% recovery rate? Which I understand, for a license holder, they may be better off. But how about registered? You know, cases involving the registered, like the recovery rate of 52%. I think this is really trivial.
Could you answer the last question? As for the fee for each item, maybe I'll ask Ms. Lee to explain to you. Assistant Director, please.
As for the calculation of the fee levels and the cost recovery, actually we take into account the operating costs, salaries and so forth, so the costs involved vary from each item to item. Of course, for newspapers registration, you want to recover 80% of the cost, and yet for other items, the recovery rate is 53% and so forth. How do you come to that?
Obviously, for the register, you know, it's even more reasonable to charge less. So if you just impose a flat rate, you don't have to make the changes every now and then. Any supplement?
No, I think no more supplement here, but we'll take into consideration members' views.
Chen Lai Wen, I'm also talking about fees here. I really find much problems with this paper, honestly. You sure you're going to raise the fees? And registration of local newspapers, the fee will go from 1,040 to 1,140, just an increase of $100.
This is an admin issue, and there should be a standard set for it. Why is it that, say, for green burials, you have to recover the costs? I know that's not something under the responsibility of your bureau, but I think we need to have unified thinking. I don't think that you are doing the fee adjustment right now. Once you actually can set up the principle of, say, recovering the full costs, say, 1400 for registrations of papers and so forth. Just then you said that you would try to impose too many adjustments to avoid causing much trouble to the sector, but the sector won't care. So either you recover, you set a fee on the basis of cost recovery or on the basis of income. Because that would be easier for you to monitor. I think your proposals now isn't that reasonable or logical. So if you're just giving me this fee
for our reference, then nothing we can say. But we have stated our views here. I hope that you will really listen to us. You know, views of my colleagues here. I've been involved in public admin for many years, though not in the government. But the problem is the government has different standards after all. So please have a more unified approach. Now you're talking about in the ward, you know, increasing the fees to help recover the costs and so forth. I think if you're going to recover the costs for livelihood matters, so why for this one, the approach is different. Nobody cares if it's just a few hundred dollars more. How do you decide on your rate of increase? And you can't tell me exactly how. So you can't just, you know, make the adjustments randomly. So my request is firstly, either you set a fee on the basis of cost recovery or on the basis of income. Please consider my views. Under Secretary, yes, I am aware of members' views, and next time when we do the review, we will consider them and see whether we can try to recover the costs in one go. And Ms. Chen just asked us about the government standards. In fact, the standards are unified. Our ultimate purpose, that is to recover the costs. But at the same time, we will try to avoid having too much an impact on the sector and the public. Therefore, we're not increasing the fees in one go. You're not going to impact the public and the sector. The papers put before us states that you're here to consult our views. In paragraph 5, you say that you want us to provide you with feedback on the proposals. Are you not accepting or are going to take on board our views, and we only consider our views much later on? So why don't you accept members' views now on the basis of what we've said and also concerning the fee items? Well, as for government fees, we need to follow the notices and principles of the Treasury. We will discuss the matter with my colleagues further and see next time whether we can actually try to incorporate members' views next time. Do you have any planning to submit to us the subsidiary legislation? We plan to submit the amended regulation next month for negative vetting. Chairman, he said by next time, did he mean that is on the basis of the fees? What does he mean by next time? Could you briefly answer Chen Lai Wen's question? Yes, I will consider her views. Attitude. Thank you, Chairman. I actually have a similar view as Claudia Mo. That is for inspection of government information. I don't think you should adopt the principle of user pays or cost recovery, because we should encourage free flow of information to let the public check the information just by paying a nominal fee. So I hope the administration will consider that. And secondly, I also don't agree that the fees mean nothing to the sector. My understanding is that, you know, for the sector, it does not include large newspapers or media companies. I understand a lot of community-based newspapers and media outlets. If you ask them to, you know, these groups to register, you know, paying $1,400 and then each year $1,200, you know, for publishers that distribute only hundreds of community newspapers and so forth, the amounts are not small at all. They are quite a big sum indeed. So would the administration for publishers with you know, community publications or newsletters give them an exemption?
get an exemption for small publishers? For the second question, for this ordinance, implementation of the ordinance so far, we haven't heard from the sector any voices, you know, concerning giving an exemption. But as many members have just said, the relevant fees, indeed, on the whole, a very minimal impact on the operating costs. So far, we don't see any need to, you know, under the ordinance, provide for any exemptions. As for attitude's first question, the user pays principle is applicable to all fee items under the government. So under the current fee levels, I don't see how they can actually affect the public's chance of getting information. Therefore, we think that the current levels are reasonable. Thank you, Chairman. Chairman, I'd like to say to the administration that there are many small community newspapers that actually are not registered at all.
If there can be some exemption of fees, I believe many community media will register with the administration. Now it's the other way around. It seems you pretend you don't see them. Sometimes such community media would like to be registered as a local newspaper. We know that is a statutory requirement, but they do not do it. Those that do it for some other reasons. I hope the Bureau will know what is actually happening on the ground and just don't say if no one comes to ask about this, they don't exist. And I won't agree with what the Undersecretary said. He says that there is no impact on people's inspection of information. Well, I don't think so, because you're raising the fees from $38 to $83. If I like to look up 10 entries and I only have a budget of $500, because I like to search and inspect the register of local newspapers, well, there is an increase of the fee to $44, but it will have an impact and a limit on the inspection that the public can do. Undersecretary, can you briefly reply whether you would allow the small media to be registered with an exemption? We'll continue to listen to views, but we do not have the plan now. Ms. Lau Siu Lai, I'd like to refer to the register of the election committee. I understand that after the registration period is over, there were two organizations. Well, but it mentions the entire election of the election committee. So I'd like the Undersecretary to reply. Why is it that there were people who were disqualified because they were regarded to be not fully connected with the sector or the subsector? Chairman, I think Ms. Lau Siu Lai is referring to the next agenda item. Yes, indeed. It is not the present item that is being discussed, because we are discussing revision of fees under the registration of local newspapers ordinance. That's right, I'll reserve my question. Mr. Cheng Chung Tai, thank you, Chairman. On the fees of revision of the under the registration of the local newspapers ordinance, I have a question. I believe the Bureau will understand that the purpose of having this ordinance is such that you don't want two newspapers to have the same name, and also you like to keep a record. My question for you is, what is management like under this ordinance? Yes, you do fee revisions, but in recent years, when there is a flourishing of internet media, and in fact they are really developing very well, my question for you is, does the Bureau have any information about the interface between this ordinance and internet media? Some of them have registered under this ordinance, but
their news gathering and their actual operation have not been dealt with fairly. Say, for example, news gathering at government meetings and the issue of news releases, etc. Do you have the relevant information?
Chairman, with regard to news gathering by media, that is the jurisdiction of the Information Services Department, my understanding is that the ISD is looking into the matter now. When there is any progress, I believe the ISD will publish the information. Well, actually, I have some information which is indicative. Some web media have been registered under the LLNO, like Civic News or Civic Passion News. It should be protected by the ordinance since it's registered under it. It should have the right to gather news. And why is it that at certain government meetings or even LegCo meetings, the Civic Passion News was not able to use its position as a registered medium under the ordinance in order to gather and report news? This is very relevant. It has to do with the purpose of the ordinance. What is the policy if you are here just to collect fees and not to supervise or manage the newspapers? Then the ordinance serves no meaningful purpose, and yet you are increasing the fees. The fees are not high, but people would be quite unhappy paying them. Now, if the purpose is really to avoid two newspapers having the same name and to keep a record, then what criteria do you use when you treat different media differently, like what you do to the Civic Passion News? Well, actually, after a medium is registered under the ordinance, the main purpose is that this can be some kind of evidence during certain legal procedures. As to the arrangements for news gathering, as I was saying, this is within the jurisdiction of the ISD. If members are expressing these views, as I said, I would be very happy to relate them to the ISD, and the ISD is actually looking into the issue. Well, member has asked me to declare interest. I'd like to say that I have already left Civic Passion News. I don't agree with what the Undersecretary said, because on the one hand, you ask these newspapers to pay you, but on the other hand, you say they may also be legally liable under the ordinance. However, they cannot exercise their rights. I think the Bureau should review the ordinance to see whether it should continue to exist. Thank you. Next, Leung Yu-chung. Chairman, there are 11 items for the increase of fees. Actually, the highest fee would just be 1,400, and some are less than 100. The fees have not been set at a high level. This time around, as members were saying, what criteria do you use in order to propose these revisions? But because of some constraints, you are only proposing increases around 10%. Well, that being said, Chairman, 10% is a shocking figure for society. If you do not look at the actual amount, 10% is quite a frightening figure. I am particularly worried about this being a bad precedent for the increase of other government fees relating to people's livelihood. In the past, when we discussed inflation, we always said whether the government will take the lead to stimulate inflation, so all fees and charges will be increased for residents. My first question is, the actual figures are not high. As some members have said, that this will not be a problem for the large operators. But what will be the impact on society as a whole? Number two,
Are you talking about these fees? Or are you talking about the entire user pays principle? No, I'm talking about this revision exercise. The lowest increase rate is 8%, the highest 17%. And I do have my worries. We have always said the government should take the lead to suppress inflation. And in fact, livelihood fees should be reduced as much as possible. But you're not doing that this time. You are increasing the fees. And I'm worried about the impact. Will this set a bad precedent for other government fees and charges? And will they also follow the rate of increase? The rate of increase, which is quite high. Chairman, members, please refer to the paper, and you will see that when we set the increases, we do have a way to calculate them. If the fee has a cost recovery rate of 40% to 70%, there are seven such fee items, the rate of increase will be 15%. If the present cost recovery rate is already over 70% and four items are in this category, the increase will not be more than 10%. This is how we proposed the rates of increase. Mr. Leung said there may be an impact on other government fees and charges. Well, actually, according to present fiscal notices, if we need to revise government fees and charges, the relevant bureaus and departments will have to first come to the Legislative Council to make a proposal to amend the regulation and consult the relevant panel before they can decide on the final fees. I believe these fees and charges are going to have different impact on the public and the sectors. But in this case, we believe such increases are totally acceptable to the public and the sector. As for other fees and charges of the government, I believe the bureaus and departments will come back and consult the Legislative Council. Well, that amounts to a very lame reply. Of course, you will come back and let us know. The thing is, you don't really ask us. You already make a proposal before you come to us. It's just like today, you are already increasing the fees and then you just come and let us know. There is not a lot of meaning in this. And I'm asking you, will this set a bad precedent impacting upon other fees and charges made by other departments? I think you attempted a reply. Would you like to supplement? Chairman, I am not of the view that this will set a bad precedent. As I said, if there is any fee revision, the bureaus and departments will have to come back to LegCo to consult members before they make a final decision and submit the amendment regulation. And the increases will be proposed on the basis of possible impact on the public and the sector. This time around, we believe the increases are acceptable to the public and the sector. As for other fees and charges, they should be considered on their own merit. Deputy Chairman, thank you. I'd like to ask a question. As members were saying, the increases are in a way negligible because they are small amounts, and also the impact on the sector will also be negligible. And some members actually said to save on administrative work, you should actually go for bigger increases. Well, I think that can be considered. But before we do that, I'd like to clarify something. I think we should apply the principle. If there will be steep increases, as a member also said, if there will be a hefty increase of a certain fee, would the same principle be applicable to other government fees and charges? and so those will be increased in a hefty manner as well. You say the amounts of increase here will be just $10, the most $100 or so, and mostly that will only impact upon the media sector. But if the principle of big increases can also be applied to other fees and charges, then the impact will be big. My question for the Bureau is, would you like to consider that in a more in-depth manner? Undersecretary, thank you, Mr. Chow, for your view. Actually, we have already said what the principle is, and that is that the ultimate goal is to ask the user to pay. But in order to avoid steep fee increases, our adjustment will be gradual. As for other fees and charges, I think the same will apply. In the circumstance, the increase is by 10 to 15%, and believe there will just be a very slight impact on the sector, and it should be acceptable. And if the same rate is applied to other fees and charges, the impact on the public may be different. And as I said just now, the bureaus and departments concerned, when they approach fee revisions, will have to act according to their policies and come back and consult the Legislative Council.
So, it really depends on how many people are affected, which sector is affected, and also the what the cost level is. Our fees, the actual level isn't high at all for them, so even a high rate of increase will only have very limited impact on the public and the sector. But for other livelihood matters, I'm sure you're all concerned about them, so I think in making adjustments for fees for those issues, I'm sure the relevant bureau will consider them carefully. Chairman, just brief supplement here. I think that in case in the future the administration would, you know, take on board members' views to increase the rate largely, as I said, I would be worried that if there's a large rate of increase, then other policy bureau and also government fees might follow the same path. And even if you were really to increase the rate largely, please explain to the public clearly that the increase will only be applied to this item, but not all government fees, because other government fees may have a much better impact or greater impact on livelihoods. Any other questions? If not, then let's move to the next item. 2017 Chief Executive Election Practical Arrangements. This item, like the previous one, we have invited all other legislative members to come in to attend this meeting. Chen Chichun? Oh, I've got a question. Only. All right. So, you've all received paper CP 283/16-17/05 provided by the administration on this item. You've also received CP 213/16-17/06 prepared by the Secretariat of the Legislature, the background brief. So I'd like to invite the administration to come in first.
都齊了嘛?
So may I ask the Undersecretary for Constitution and Main Affairs, Mr. Ronald Chan, to take us through the paper before members can ask questions. Thank you, Chairman. The 2017 Chief Executive Election will be held on March 26 next year. And the election committee will select the new Chief Executive. The Electoral Affairs Commission, actually through the RUO will make preparations for the arrangements, and the election committee and also the Electoral Affairs Commission are making preparations for the election, and the RUO has prepared for you the paper for the practical arrangements. So I'd like to ask the Chief Principal Electoral Officer to take us through the details. Thank you. This paper will explain to members the practical arrangements for the election of the fifth term chief executive. And the election committee is responsible for electing CE and members of EC are electors in CE election. And December 11, there will be the EC sub-sector elections. And the term of the EC will commence on February 1st, 2017. And the CE election will be held on March 26, 2017. The nomination period will begin from February 14 to March 1st next year. It will be accepted later on. The main polling station and the central counting station will be located at the HKCEC. Like other elections, the returning officer will designate the area outside the MPS as no canvassing zone and a no staying zone. We will also, at nearby police stations, set up a dedicated polling station for those electors who are imprisoned or remanded under custody of the Correctional Services Department. If needed, we would actually ask them to set up a DPS in a police station in the vicinity of the HKCEC. We will also include a counting zone, media center, central command center, and a statistical information center at the CCS. The CCS will oversee the conduct of the poll and vote counting to provide central command and help desk support services. The media center will disseminate information about the counting results to the candidates, media, and the public. There are designated zones within the MC for media, electors, candidates, and their agents, in the public gallery for the members. The SIC will collect and consolidate voter turnout statistics and to check the counting results and announce them in real time. Within 10 days after the polling day, the polling day, the electors will be given information on the guidelines for elections and voting instructions and details of the polling counting procedures. And also, if there are more than one or two nominated candidates, we will carry various systems of voting. In a contested election, when there are three or more validly nominated candidates, any of them in the first round obtains more than 600 valid votes in the first round of the election, he will be elected. Otherwise, as mentioned in paragraph 15, there will be elimination procedure. And the same elimination and voting procedures will be repeated until any end of any subsequent round of voting, the candidate obtains more than 600 valid votes. And if there are only two remaining candidates with valid votes, after the elimination of all, or there are only two remaining candidates after the elimination of all other candidates, then any candidate wins 600 valid votes. That candidate will be returned at the election. If there's no candidate that receives more than 600 valid votes on that day, then the election procedures will be terminated. And then, say, if the election stops on March 2016, then by May 7, there will be a new polling date for the election after the termination of the proceedings for the election. And there will be various rounds of voting from 9 to 11 a.m., 2 to 3 p.m., and 7 to 8 p.m., depending on the rounds of voting needed on the polling day. And we'll make announcements on the CCC, and we'll also inform candidates of the day for the next voting day. We also consolidate information of the electors and to text message or email them about the latest round of voting. And if there is a need for a fourth round or further rounds of voting, it will be held on the following day, that is March 27, at the same polling stations. If everything goes smoothly, the voting will begin on March 26, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m., according to plan. Anyone who gets 600 votes will be declared the winner. If any candidate does not receive more than 600 votes, that candidate would not win the election, and the election procedures will be terminated, and a new round of nomination may be needed. If needed, we may need to repeat the necessary electoral process until a candidate is returned. The vote counting will be carried out at the CCS, and there will be actually a returning officer who will take charge of the counting zone. And questionable ballot papers will first be separated during the counting process by the RO. And candidates and the agents may make representations during the termination process. The decision of the RO on the validity of ballot papers is final under the electoral law. If there's no request for a recount, the RO will at the media center announce the results of the vote count. We will comply with the relevant electoral law requirements and design the ballot papers. We will use various papers to differentiate various rounds of voting. And the each candidate can really mail election advertisements to their electors. The REO will provide each candidate with two sets of electors' address labels. Except the electors who have provided REO with their email address. We also provide for each candidate a computer disk, referred to as a candidate mailing label system, containing the mailing information of electors. And the candidate can actually mail their election advertisements to them or disseminate the advertisements to the electors via emails. To protect the privacy of electors, after obtaining the address labels and the CMLS, the candidates must sign an undertaking regarding the use of the information of electors. Under existing law, to comply with the public inspection requirement, candidates may deposit of the EAs and the relevant information with the RO or post the electronic copies of these documents onto a central platform maintained by the CEO or as an open platform maintained by the candidate for public inspection within one working day after the publication of the election advertisements in the manner and time specified by the Electoral Affairs Commission. So the candidates can actually publicize the election manifestos. And we have decided that the size of the introduction to the candidates will remain at one A4 page for each candidate. I'm going to be finished. Please wait till he's finished. We can't. He's almost done. Please continue. We will continue to adopt various measures to reduce paper consumption or election-related materials. Please refer to paragraph 35 in the paper. Chairman, I've just briefed you on the practical arrangements on the CE election. Thank you. So it's now time for Q&A. 4 minutes for each member. We may have a second round of Q&A if needed. The first one, Claudia Mo. Thank you, Chairman. On the practical arrangements and so forth, I'm basically clear about them. But for the election itself, you mean the elector candidates? I'd like to ask the electoral officer, why is it that we heard that, you know, for university students, they are not included in the higher education sector? But there's a university student whose name is Cheng Shaoyin. He used to be on the CHUK Senate. So he's no ordinary university student, but you said that his connection with the higher education sector is insufficient. But there are also candidates in the engineering sector who are actually bar bending workers who's disqualified. And you said that their connection with the sector is inadequate. But given your logic, I'd like to ask you, how about agriculture and fisheries sector? How come in that sector there are people with the title of managers, secretaries, you know, as elected candidates? Agriculture and fisheries sector, there are 60 seats, double the number in the legal sector. So what are your criteria in abolishing one's status as an eligible elector or not? How do you draw the line? But how is it related to the practical arrangements? This is related to the election. Could you respond? Please. As for the sub-elector election, or use a sub-sector election, the electoral officer has to follow the law in making decisions. Indeed, under the CE election ordinance, on who is eligible
or not eligible or lost the qualification to join the subsidiary election, there are provisions there in the ordinance already. As for what it means by close links, in the schedule of the relevant ordinance, there is an explanation on close link. So that's a guideline for the electoral officer. But how come there are such big discrepancies here in the agriculture and fisheries sector? How come there are managers and secretaries there who are electors, and yet there are no frontline staff, you know, or metal or bar bending workers who cannot stand in the engineering sector? Well, I can't comment on individual cases. You need to explain to the public why. In general, as I said, the C election ordinance stipulates clearly what we mean by closed links. In making a decision, the electoral officer has to consider the composition of a subsector and the constituency's concern. Each subsector, according to the law, is different, and the constituency varies. Therefore, for various constituencies, you need to have a close link with the sector to become eligible as an elector. So the definition or the requirement vary depending on the provisions in the ordinance. The electoral officer, in making a decision on who whose nomination is valid, he needs to consider the relevant legal requirements.
And in the process, sorry, you are not replying to my question. Let me just ask you this. Can you tell the public that the disqualification of candidates, well, that is done by the returning officer. Can you tell the public that this does not involve any political censorship or the friend or foe mentality? Can you say for 100% sure? Well, I am 100% sure. Nothing of that sort at all. The election work and all decisions have been done according to strict legal requirements. In the process, if the returning officer rules whether a candidate is eligible, and if he has doubts, he can ask the advice of the advisory committee, who will give an independent legal opinion. So the returning officer must pay heed to the independent legal view of the advisory committee according to law. That is why all decisions made by the RO or the returning officer must be done according to the law. Ms. Lau Siu Lai, actually the public are very concerned about the disqualification of candidates. I hope you will quickly answer the question and also in a detailed manner. Why is it that the criterion of having close links with the sector can be so different for the different subsectors? We remember in 2005, two people were eligible even if they had left district councils for 2 years. And why is it that Mr. Cheng Xiaoyin is disqualified only if he has been 8 months away from the relevant university body? And also, according to para 4.92 of the guidelines, which says if the returning officer has doubts about the background or qualification of the candidates, he should ask for extra information to be submitted. Why is it that the returning officer has not done this in these cases? A detailed reply from you, please. Undersecretary, Chairman, as I said, I should not be commenting on individual cases here. But, and as I explained, when the RO makes a decision, he has to follow the law and its requirements strictly. In considering whether a candidate is having close links with the subsector, the schedule of the law has already given guidelines on what is close link, and generally, the returning officer will have to look at the composition of the subsector and the electorate base. You will understand that even according to the law, these two vary for the different subsectors. So who would be eligible under this criterion of close links? It naturally varies for the subsectors.
Overall speaking, it has to comply with the legal requirements. And secondly, the returning officer can seek legal opinions from the advisory committee. And then, according to the law, when he makes a decision, he will have to avail himself to the independent legal view of the advisory committee. But he did not ask the candidates to supply extra information. There is no opportunity for the candidates to prove that he may have close links. Chairman, I will not comment on individual cases, but I have already repeated many times that the RO will have to act strictly according to the law. What about the REO? Will the REO like to come in on this question? Well, nothing much, Mr. Chairman. As the Undersecretary said, the decision will be made by the RO according to the law's requirements. And the situation for the different subsectors varies. And we can't say that if something is done for one subsector, it should be done for another subsector. Well, but then many residents are calling up and are reflecting to us that they are very concerned about this. Why is it that for the different subsectors, the so-called close links are so different? Why is it that in the agriculture and farming subsector, some people are obviously not farming, they are not keeping any animals? Why is it they are regarded as eligible? But then for the education subsector, if someone has been away from a relevant body for just a few months and he is already disqualified, shouldn't you explain to the public? Chairman, actually, I don't think I have further supplements to make. As I said, I should not be commenting on individual cases here. But let me just make one point. The decision of the returning officer is, say, if he rules that someone is ineligible and that nomination is invalid, he would have given his reasons in the nomination form, and that can be inspected by the public. And the public can certainly inspect those nomination forms in order to know the justifications of the RO. Mr. Ray Chan, the CE election will take place on the 26th of March 2017. From what we know, probably there will be a electoral by-election. The public want to know very much whether the two elections would be too close to each other. My first question is for the REO. What are your plans? Say, if you can't have the electoral by-election in February, you are not going to do it in March. Are you thinking along these lines? Or, in fact, are you planning to conduct the electoral by-election only after the CE election? Now, this is a relevant question because when we stood for the electoral election, we also thought about whether if we ask somebody not to support CY Leung, would that amount to an election advertisement? Of course, today, Mr. CY Leung has not announced his candidature. And of course, the nomination period starts from the 14th of February. Now, if by the time CY Leung has already nominated his candidature, and if in another election the candidates ask people not to support a certain candidate of another election, then there may be the problem of election advertisements. Has the REO thought about it? This is quite a practical issue. Can the Undersecretary please reply? First of all, for the EAC to trigger an election procedure, first of all, the clerk to the Legislative Council, when he knows about a vacancy in the Legislative Council, he will have to gazette to announce it within 21 days, and then the by-election will be triggered. The EAC will then, according to the law, arrange for the by-election. The date of the by-election will be decided according to the actual circumstances. Actually, the clerk to the Legislative Council has not gazetted anything, so the EAC has no need to make considerations. No, I'm asking you about the principles. Is it that you will not want to place two elections too close to each other, say, for example, within 1 month? I think you should get prepared for such a scenario. Chairman, when the EAC considers the time and date for a by-election, apart from the legal requirements, the EAC has to consider many practical issues. One, manpower resources. Polling stations. Will we have enough polling stations? Please do not beat about the bush. Come back to the principle. When you face the situation, what are your plans?
Chairman,
the clerk to the Legislative Council has not gazetted a vacancy. The EAC will have to wait for the gazette to announce a vacancy before considering arranging for a by-election. Within 6 months, is that right?
Chairman, the law doesn't say.
It doesn't stipulate within how much time the EAC has to conduct a by-election after gazetto by the clerk to the Legislative Council. It just says that 4 months before the next term, there will not be a by-election. But when the by-election will be conducted, the EAC will have to act according to the law. Okay, my next question is, if the candidate of another election tells people not to support a certain candidate to the CE election, will that amount to an election advertisement? Can the REO shed light on this?
Chairman, actually, at the CAP meeting last term, this was discussed. The point is,
we have to look at the purpose of the statement, whether it amounts to helping or deterring a certain candidate. And so it depends on the intention of the statement, and actually the definition is already in the relevant election laws.
Mr. Christopher Chung.
Chairman, thank you. Talking about the CE election, I have my regrets. If not for the Democratic camp vetoing the political reform package, Ms. Claudia Mo's and Ms. Lau Siu Lai's questions will not be questions anymore. Today, we should actually be speaking about 5 million people casting the votes to return the CE instead of 1,080 people. I have read the REO paper, and I can see that the administration has not given a specific account of the publicity for CE candidates. I'd like to ask the administration, how do you plan to publicize the 2017 CE election to the public so the public can understand that even if the CE is not returned by one man, one vote, he will be broadly representative instead of what the Democrats are saying, that he is returned by a small circle election. What is more important? We have to allow the public to feel that the election is related to their daily lives. So the CE election will be more credible. All in all, I hope the administration will not be too superficial and formal in its publicity work. Don't just appeal for a clean election and those eligible should vote. You should be more in-depth and detailed in mounting publicity so people will feel that the CE election is closely related to them. Any response?
Chairman,
the REO will make use of different channels, will issue press releases, will post posters, we will broadcast APIs on television and radio, we'll also take out advertisements in many newspapers in Hong Kong in order to publicize the nomination period and the polling date of the CE election. The REO will also set up a CE election website in order to provide one-stop information to the public. I hope the administration will not just face 1,200 residents who are electors. You should mount publicity for the entire public.
Mr. Cheng Chung Tai.
Thank you, Chairman.
First, I'd like to reiterate BCE election is a hand-picking game, and it has nothing whatsoever to do with the 7 million people in Hong Kong. Every time we just look at the liaison office and also the SAR government and the local communists trying to manipulate local opinion. But this time around, during the nomination period of the CE election, many things happened, and one of which is the interpretation of the basic law by the MPCSC. I'd like to ask the REO, when the subsectors are being nominated for the election committee, and also during the selection for the election committee, are you getting prepared about possible litigation taken out by residents of Hong Kong against certain candidates who may have a foreign passport? Are you getting prepared for such a scenario? REO. Who will take the question? Chairman, number one, I do not agree with what Mr. Chang said, that the CE election is only a matter for the 1,200 people. I believe people in different sectors and the different industries show a lot of care towards the CE election. Actually, the CE has a very special constitutional position in Hong Kong.
All its policies are closely related to the public. So we will strictly abide by legal requirements to stage a good election. I'm sure that's what's actually in line with public expectations. Any supplement from the REO? Let me interrupt. You're saying that, you know, you hope that the CE election is, you know, in line with public expectations. The 1,200 electors, I'm worried about whether any of them hold foreign passports. So to the administration, have you weighed or considered the people who hold public passports and yet take a oath for public duty, and do you think that case will be subject to judicial review? Who are qualified to stand in the EC subsector elections? As I said, our electoral legislations have clear stipulations on that. Our returning officer, in deciding who are eligible, whether his nomination is valid, would strictly follow the legal requirements. Any supplement from electoral officer? The EC subsector election candidates have to be aged 18 or above, and who are registered voters. Unlike electoral or members or CE election, whose candidates, you know, these candidates would not be required to declare an oath on where they have a foreign passport. That is, in the EC subsector elections, there's no such requirement for oath taking. So I want to clarify, in other words, you mean that the electors do not need to make a statement or take an oath on becoming an election committee member, right? There's no such legal requirement, yes, for them to take an oath. So in other words, the electors won't need to take an oath, yes. In other words, if you have foreigners who can be an elector, so I'd like to ask the REO, do you think that there's a need to, you know, in line with the political climate now, require electors to take an oath? Please be brief. In carrying out all elections, we have to follow the law. Next one is Leung Chi Chung. I remember when the secretary for Carrie Lam came to Legco to explain the interpretation of the basic law saga. I asked a similar question, but let me ask this again. On the submission of forms to take part in the CE election, would it happen as in Legco this year that the candidate concerned would be asked to sign a statement declaring that he upholds Hong Kong SAR and the basic law? Will there be such a statement that the candidates will be asked to sign? Do you mean the confirmation letter or a statement? I remember for the recent legislative election, there is a statement. You mean confirmation letter? Well, in previous legislative elections, there was no requirement for such a statement. So for the CE election, would it follow the example of the legislative election to have the statement? Let me explain. Based on the CE election ordinance, any candidates for the CE election or the nomination of the candidates has to come with a statement in which the candidate will need to declare that he will uphold the basic law and pledge allegiance to the Hong Kong SAR. That has been a requirement that's always been in the law. And so such declaration is in the nomination form. And also to ensure that candidates clearly understand the basic law when they stand up for election, the REO has also prepared a confirmation letter for the returning officer to assist the returning officer to carry out his duties in accordance with the law and to judge whether the candidate is validly nominated, and is also intended to help the candidates to ensure that they clearly understand the basic law. I remember during the electoral election, there were some candidates after they were nominated who were disqualified because their behaviors and words in the past did not fulfill the requirement in the statement. So for the upcoming election, would you adopt a similar approach, returning officer? Well, as I said, the candidates will need to strictly comply with the legal requirements, and the statement will help the returning officer confirm whether the candidate actually is a valid nominee. If necessary, the returning officer can ask the candidate to provide further information so that the officer is satisfied that the candidate's nomination is valid. So it all depends on, during the nomination period, what the candidate concerned, has said or done. So as for the dedicated polling station, you have compress the time for voting at that station to 1 hour. Do you think that's fair to the electors? We expect for the dedicated polling station, only a very small number of people will be using them. So based on past experience, 1 hour of voting will be enough. And we also reserve time. And to move the ballot box to the central polling station from the dedicated polling station. There are still a few members who haven't asked questions. Helena Wong, Wu Chi Wai, Kwok Ka Ki, Kwang Chun Yu, Yu Chung Yi, Tanya Chan, and so forth. Any other members who would like to ask questions, please raise your hands. If not, I will draw a line here. Because we only have limited time, I can only extend the meeting by 15 minutes. Can I ask questions now? You can. I just want to draw a line in case we don't have enough time, because each one of you only have 4 minutes. And we've got 8 members in the queue now. Next one, Helena Wong. Thank you, Chairman. I'm very much concerned about, in some sectors, subsectors, where the potential electors are DQ'd, disqualified. Even though the Undersecretary said he didn't want to comment on individual cases, but I'd like the administration to clearly explain to us, are they using the same criteria across the board, say in the agriculture and fisheries sector, the electors are similar, and their jobs are all related. But it made us wonder whether the administration is really adopting the same criteria for all subsectors. You know, in dealing with all nominees. If you have different criteria, please let us know. And there are some public concerns now and suspicion. So the administration needs to explain to us whether you are, you know, across the board adopting the same criteria in deciding whether an elector is valid. And also, there are various time frames in the paper that is, for example, the subsector election, which will be on December 11. There are also dates for the nomination period for the CE, that is from February 14 to March 1st, and the chief executive election will be held on March 26. But people also want to know who will stand for the CE election. So far, of course, we are very concerned that, you know, Siwa Leung, we hope that he won't stand for re-election. But we can't stop him, of course, if he wants to. So if the existing CE or secretaries want to stand in the next CE election, is there a deadline when they need to resign and announce their intention to stand in the election? Chairman, for the first question, we only have one set of criteria, that is the election ordinance. Any candidate, whether they are qualified or not, will depend on what the law says. That's very clear, clearly spelled out in the law. Secondly, on your question on secretaries, where they can stand in the election, similarly, the CE election and CE candidates' qualifications are stipulated in the ordinance, where it's mentioned that for some designated senior public officers that are not fit to stand, they include the existing officials in the political appointment system. What about the CE himself? What about CE? He can't retire. He can't resign, right? To take part, right? Well, the incumbent chief executive, under the current law, he would not need to resign. He can remain in duty while taking part in the election. That's been the practice in previous elections. So what mechanism is there to ensure that he would not use public resources to carry out his own electioneering campaign? Well, the CE election guidelines have clear guidelines. There are clear guidelines on election activities. The bigger principle is that whoever who's in public service, whether it's the CE or not, should not use public resources to promote their electioneering campaign. So for people in the political appointment system, when is the latest they need to resign if they want to stand in the election? Undersecretary? As long as he's resigned and no longer a senior official, that is, no longer has any public duty, then and he fits the other criteria, that he can stand. That means there's no answer for me. I think he answered you. That is, when you join the election, you should not be a principal officer. Then you can take part. Doesn't mean that, that is, he can resign a day before the end of the nomination period. Yeah, it depends on when his resignation takes effect. Next one, Lam Chut Ting. I'd like to ask the secretary, undersecretary. Now we've got the interpretation by the MPC on the basic law. And after that, the content of the confirmation letter and the statement, would it be adjusted in light of the latest interpretation? That is because, you know, whether you would add the word "and," you know, in terms of being loyal to the Hong Kong SAR and the PRC. As I said, the CE elections ordinance already requires the candidates to sign a statement upholding the basic law and be loyal to the HKSAR. And the EAC will also provide for a confirmation letter to ensure that the candidates understand the relevant context of the basic law. My question is whether it needs to be written in the statement that the candidates is loyal to the PLC, because that's included in the interpretation of the basic law. the latest interpretation? Well, I just then mentioned the statement according to the local law, the statement that candidates would need to sign, and also confirmation letter by the EAC. Whether there's interpretation of the basic law or not, we will follow the same requirement for the CE election. Chairman, I think the Undersecretary has not answered my question. I was asking whether they will add the words being loyal to CE, People's Republic of China and HKSRL, because those who have announced their intention to stand in the election includes Justice Wu Kwok-hing, who admitted that he has British nationality. My understanding is that if you have a British nationality, then you need to be loyal to Britain. If that's the case, then whether his pledge of allegiance or loyalty to PLC is questionable. And if a returning officer, because if considering his previous behavior, he declares that Justice Wu's declaration is insincere, then it means that the returning officer could disqualify Justice Wu, from standing, even though he has 115 nominations. It's like in the past, the returning officer can say that, because they doubt people's sincerity in their claim of upholding the basic law, and then, they can disqualify the candidates. A CE election candidate cannot have foreign right of a vote. But I'm saying that in the past, some returning officers were on the basis of the acts and deeds of and the words of the candidate to decide whether he's qualified. So his past deeds and words, would that cause him his qualification to be made invalid?
Yes.
Okay, I won't waste your time, Undersecretary. Let me give an explanation in detail. According to the CEEO, there should be a statement attached to the nomination of a candidate, and the statement should state that the candidate is taking part in a personal capacity and he will uphold the basic law, and he confirms that he will swear allegiance to the Hong Kong SAR. And also, it will have to state whether this candidate is of a certain nationality and whether he has foreign right of abode. All these have to be described in the statement attached to the nomination. We know all that. The thing is, if this person has held a foreign nationality, can the returning officer come to an opinion that because of that, the present statement or the present oath to uphold the basic law and to swear allegiance to the Hong Kong SAR is insincere, so that his qualification should be made invalid? Why can't you answer the question? Chairman, it's difficult for me to comment on individual cases or give a general answer. I can only say that when the RO decides whether a candidate's nomination is valid, he will have to act according to election laws. Mr. Wu Chi-wai. Thank you, Chair. 2 points. One, the Inner Secretary emphasized time and again that when the returning officer has to make a decision to disqualify certain candidates, he will seek legal opinions. I'd like to ask about the disqualification of candidates for subsector elections. Is it that the RO sought legal opinion for disqualify each and every nominated candidate? If that's the case, can that kind of legal opinion be published so the public will understand the basis for the RO to disqualify certain candidates? Undersecretary, Chairman, I do not have information about the cases at hand, so I don't want to comment on the details of individual cases. Chairman, the Undersecretary said time and again that if the RO has doubts that when he needs to disqualify a candidate, he will have to seek legal opinion. It's just like during the legislative election. It is said that when candidates were disqualified, there would be a legal opinion supporting that kind of decisions. Well, even if you count it today, Undersecretary, can you supplement the information afterwards about the basis for coming to a view that there are not close links between a candidate and the subsector? Why is it that in certain circumstances you allow this candidate to go through and in other cases the candidates cannot go through? Mr. Undersecretary, the question is, when you make a nomination invalid, will you also include the legal opinion in the letter?
Chairman, as I said, if the RO rules that a candidate's nomination is invalid, he will have to record his reasons on the nomination form of that candidate. And like other election information, the nomination form is available for public inspection. If the public are interested in materials or documents supplied by any candidates, including the ruling of disqualification, the public can inspect the nomination forms concerned. The thing is, whether the justifications given would include the legal opinion. Chairman, I believe when the RO makes a decision, the justifications will be based on the legal opinion received, and then the RO will come to a final decision. As to what justifications will be given in the nomination form, how it will be described, I don't think I can comment on that. No, I like to have more information for reference. I think this is important because candidates, well, should know. I'm not exactly talking about this case only. I like to know in what circumstances I will be disqualified because I am seen not to have close links with the subsector. Undersecretary, did you say the letter is a public document? Well, yes, it is for public inspection. But does it include the document including the legal opinion? Chairman, I can't give the details of every case. No, I'm just saying whether the legal opinion can be inspected by the public. Generally speaking, when a public officer discharges his public duties and if he needs to seek legal opinion, usually that legal opinion is not made public. But when the RO makes a decision, as I said, he will have to record his reasons on the nomination form. And his opinion will have to be reached according to the independent legal view he has received. So this is working behind closed doors because you're not telling the public what the legal opinion is. You will just have to say, I am disqualifying you because you don't have close links with the subsector. That's it. Well, the time is up. Please be very brief. Chairman, I cannot comment on the individual cases. Dr. K.K. Kwok. Chairman, this is very interesting indeed. The Undersecretary doesn't comment on anything. You are wasting your time, you are wasting our time. Because, as a matter of fact, the ordinance is worded in a very strange way. Cap 569, Schedule 17. We're asking you for the principles, not about individual cases. So can you not comment on the principles? Why is it that many people are seen not to have any connection with the agriculture and farming subsector, but they are allowed? But then for the engineering sector, education sector, some students who are still in a tertiary institute are disqualified. Let's talk about the principles, not individual cases. You are setting up the RO, yet I believe you have some principles for him to work by. Chairman, in fact, I have talked about the principles a few times. Chairman, today we, in fact, would like to tell members the practical arrangements for the election of the CE. I don't know whether it is really appropriate. Well, you can answer briefly. We have heard that many times, but Dr. K.K. Kwok was not in the room. Can you not tell him the principles briefly again? Overall speaking, when the RO makes a decision as to whether the nomination is valid, whether the candidate is qualified, he has to make a decision according to the law. Close connection has been explained in the law as a guideline to the RO. Generally speaking, when ROs make a decision,
he will have to consider the composition of the subsector and the electorate base. If necessary, he can seek the independent legal opinion of the advisory committee and then make a decision. Chairman, this is the overall or overarching principle. Well, you haven't talked about any principle at all. If at all, you are just saying whether he is one of your gang. As you can see, for the agriculture and farming industry, many candidates just are not taking any part in the industry. Some are company secretaries, some are clerical people. They don't know even how to use an axe. They haven't been in the sea to fish for even one day, and yet they can be a candidate for the subsector. So you have not told us any principles. Undersecretary, my question for you is, when you pick these candidates for the subsectors, I think, first of all, you have to make sure that they are one of your own, and two, that they will listen to your commands, and three, if they are from the democratic camp, you would want to disqualify them using unreasonable reasons. Can I say that? I think that is a more apt description. Chairman, I cannot agree at all with Dr. Kwok's interpretation. Whether it be the EAC, the returning officer, or other public officers responsible electorate procedures, they have acted according to the principle of political neutrality, and they conduct elections according to the law. And definitely, there is no such consideration as depicted by K.K. Kwok. Why is it that some people are disqualified? Chairman, I think I've explained many times, I have no supplement. Chairman, most unfortunate. We know this is a small circle election, and we would know the result before the election is over, and those who are not one of them will not be included. But then you have done an ugly job in this drama. This is already a very ugly small circle election, and this is still what you are doing. And Hong Kong people will view this as a show. It's a farce. Mr. Roy Kwong, Chairman. Chairman, I'd like to reiterate again that I beg to differ from K.K. Kwok. Mr. Roy Kwong. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, a pro-establishment camp member said that last year, the Democratic camp vetoed the constitutional reform, so it is regrettable. I think what is most regrettable is that the pro-establishment camp was waiting for Mr. Lau Wong Fat and they did not even cast their vote. I think the Undersecretary has a difficult job talking to us about the practical arrangements. I must apologize for this situation, but as you know, so many things have happened and you must be prepared for such questions. But of course, it's not your fault. You just said you will not comment on cases and you only act according to the principle because you're empowered by the law. Now, if that is the case, why is there such a big gray area for people to be disqualified? I'd like to ask about that yardstick. There are so many subjective reasons. Cheng Xiaoyin is one example. How would close connections be decided? Undersecretary, as I said, Chairman, there is only one yardstick, and that is the election law. Anyone who comes forward will be evaluated by the RO as to his nomination, whether it's valid and whether he is qualified. That will be done according to the law. Chairman, do you know there is this joke recently that you do not depend, it doesn't depend on your IQ or EQ to be the CE. It depends on DQ, meaning disqualification. I think there is a vote rigging, even in this CE election. As you know, someone has not even fished for one day. He can't even use a plow to plow the land, but he can be a candidate of the subsector. And this time around, it is the same thing. It will be only Leung fans who will be accepted. We have seen disqualification for the social welfare subsector, engineering subsector, and education subsector. Of course, you are doing it at no cost to you, but you are destroying our time-honored values. Undersecretary, is this rule of law or rule of man? Secretary, Undersecretary, Chairman, anyone who takes part in election, whether it is the election committee, subsector election, or electrical election, or the CE election, they have to act according to the law in order to take part and also go about their electioneering activities. It is only like this that we can make sure that our elections are fair, open, and honest. And all along, we are acting only according to one yardstick, and that is our election law. Anyone who is involved as a public officer will act according to the law to conduct the election. In our system, it is also stated clearly that if anyone disagrees with the decision of a public officer, there is a mechanism for them to resort to the legal channel or judicial channel. But we will have to wait till the entire election is over, and it is not meaningful anymore. The thing is, someone wants to enter or join this election committee, but he is forbidden to do so. And even if you want to take it up judicially, you have to wait 1-2 years before you know why. The yardstick is in your hands, not in the hands of the public. You are not convincing the public why someone is accepted, another one is not. These are the worries in the public's mind, Under Secretary. My question for you is, therefore, why is it that the returning officer is satisfied with somebody and not another? Are you setting up the RO? Chairman, I can't agree at all with Mr. Roy Kwong, because when the RO makes a decision, he totally is politically neutral.
And even the candidates, when he joined the election, he needs not tell the returning officer what his political stance is. Whatever his stance, the returning officer will use the same yardstick in deciding whether he's qualified or not, whether his nomination is valid. So for the entire process, we strictly follow the law. Next one is Yu Chung Yim. Follow up on what's been asked. Just as many members were asking, you know, people who want to be in the agriculture and fisheries sector as an elector, and some are disqualified. The Undersecretary had on various occasions failed to give us a reason why. Those who are disqualified to stand in the subsector election can, through various legal channels, to make inspections. But my question is, those who are accepted, you know, through their claims of connections with the sector and whose nomination is accepted, do we have any channel for us to check why these people are accepted? So can the administration tell us, for those who are accepted, for those cases, provide to electrical information so we know that, you know, fitting or what sort of criteria would be useful for confirming one's qualification. So we all know from now on, you know, what to follow instead of having, you know, candidates being disqualified. Undersecretary, I think within, you know, for electrical, all along we would not comment on individual cases or providing information in relation to individual cases. But if Edward Yu, through his course of work, discovers anyone that he thinks is not qualified and yet ultimately is made a candidate in the subsector election, he can actually lodge an appeal, you know, in relation to the case. Any follow-up, Mr. Yu? So isn't it that you are, in other words, encouraging the public to cast doubts and then find out for them, you know, who's qualified? So are you putting the burden of proof on the public, or whether you will provide some sort of, you know, clear ideas on what are the criteria that you accept? Even if we want to provide evidence, we need to know what the government's stance or criteria are. And that would do away with any unnecessary doubts or acts to try to collect evidence.
Undersecretary?
I don't have any more to say, indeed, because I have various times reiterated that our returning officer, in deciding whether one's nomination is qualified, we need to, or they need to, follow the law, per se. If a candidate's nomination is valid, then of course we are confident that the returning officer, in considering his case, would accept that he's qualified in accordance with the law, and that the nomination itself is in line with the legal requirements before the returning officer would rule the nomination as valid. As I said, our election system is fair and just. If there's anyone who thinks that some candidates should not be qualified and yet are made candidates, then there are actually judicial means for the public to lodge appeals. My final question. Generally speaking, if the law is not written clearly, then the government would issue guidelines. So would the administration on this matter, since there are so many grey areas involved, would you provide guidelines to support the law?
Undersecretary?
Under our election system, our nominating advisory committee can provide legal advice, and the advice that they offer will not be made only to the returning officer, but also to individual candidates or any members of the public, you know, who have doubts about the qualifications of candidates. And so the committee can provide legal advice upon request. Next one, Tanya Chen. On the CE election, I'd like to ask, for the candidates for the CE election, would they be required to sign a confirmation letter?
Undersecretary,
yes. So, Undersecretary, under what ordinance is the signing of the confirmation letter required? You said you have the same yardstick and you follow the law. But on this CE election ordinance, cap 569, well, just then there's mentioned that the nomination form on it was same for the legislative election. That is, on the nomination form, there's a statement claiming that the candidate will be a legend, loyal to the HKSAR, and uphold the basic law. And the same section 1617 bracket Roman letter 2, same provision there. No, you know, for anyone who is participating in the election and who's aged about 40, on what grounds would you think that some candidates would not understand what sort of form he's signing, and yet he has to, therefore he has to sign another confirmation letter? Undersecretary? Besides the CE election ordinance mentioned by Ms. Chen, you may also refer to the Chapter 4 and Section 4 and 5 under the EAC Ordinance, under which the Commission can adopt appropriate measures or make decisions if things appropriate to ensure that LegCo and other elections are open and just. We've heard this section before, but this section is like applicable to all scenarios. But you are just then saying that you want to assist the returning officer to clearly understand or make sure that the candidates know their responsibilities. But for candidates in the CE election, on what grounds would the returning officer doubt that whether the candidates, CE election candidates, would not be clear about the requirement? The EEC, is it that those who does not sign the confirmation letter are not clear about the content of the nomination form? When I stood in the last national election, I didn't sign the confirmation letter. Does it mean that I'm not upholding the basic law, nor being loyal to HKSAR? I'd just like to ask you, on what basis would you rule that a candidate is not clear about what the nomination form says? Well, the EAC, in issuing the confirmation letter, it has noticed some acts and words in Hong Kong which have deviated from one country two systems, and the EAC also has doubts whether some candidates clearly understand the basic law.
Given that the EAC launches the confirmation letters to help the returning officer carry out their duties.
Yes, I understand. But for returning officers, they are to help the candidates, or you want to help them implement their duty. But there are still cases piling up in the court. Very soon, there will be the CE election. So I'd like to ask you whether there will be a need for another interpretation of the basic law so that the a civil servant or returning officer would not be used to plug any loopholes. Would you go for the go down the path of the interpretation of the basic law again? Well, I haven't heard of any plans to have another interpretation of the basic law. But basic law cap 2016 gives everyone the right to stand in election and be elected. If you have another interpretation, that would definitely have a devastating effect on the rule of law in Hong Kong. So please think twice. Next one, Kin Yun. My question is, on the C election, in the paper, it says that the C candidate must get at least 600 votes to be declared a winner. So, if you, or if any candidate does not have 600 votes, in the first round he will be eliminated. Then leaving, for example, the two remaining candidates for the next round of voting. If no clear winner emerges, then the same voting procedure will take place and be repeated until someone gets the 600 votes to win. So that's the arrangement for the election. In the past, I thought that that shouldn't be problematic, but in the current term or current election, whether a candidate gets 600 votes, that's possible in the future election. If that's the case, then what will be the arrangement? In paragraph 19 of the paper, you said that there could be a new polling date, which will be 42nd day after the termination of the proceedings for the election, which is May 7, 2017. And how about the third polling day? Would you have a day for the third voting if that's needed? Would it be 42 days later? If so, which will mean the end of June next year. In case there's a need for the fourth polling date, then that will be July, after July next year. So in other words, that would overlap with the end of term of the CE. Should that be the case? It said that the current CE would, on June 30th, finish his term. And then there could be a vacuum period of the CE until a new polling date is arranged. And the Secretary, before you answer, I'd like to extend this meeting by 15 minutes. Any objection? No, okay. Undersecretary, maybe I'll ask Mr. Wong to talk about the practical arrangements first. Yes, on Mr. Ip's first question, based on the C election ordinance, after the termination of the proceedings for the election, the new polling day will be a Sunday after that. So in other words, for the second round of polling, it will be May 7 for the second polling. If the second polling still cannot produce a chief executive, which will be the 42nd days later, which will be June 18th, the third polling day. Undersecretary, I believe the chances for this happening is extremely low. That is by July 1st. That there isn't yet a clear winner for the CE election, then according to the law, the CE office or the CE position will be vacant. And should that happen, then the existing officials, that is the chief secretary, will become an interim CE. Shouldn't the term of office end
on the same day? Well, for all key officials, they are centrally appointed. Therefore, should there be, you know, the case that on July 1st there's no CE in office, based on the basic law, there's chief secretary for administration, financial secretary, and the justice secretary would fill in the posts. Main question here: the chief secretary for administration. My understanding is the term of office would end on June 30th. But if there's no clear result from the CE election, then each of the officials you mentioned will just go one step higher on the ladder, official ladder. But the election will be kept conducting, and those who does not get 600 votes will continue to be voted on again. And maybe the person may want to insist on trying his luck, then there may not be new candidates or new nominations, then we could actually find ourselves in a bottleneck. So should this constitutional crisis occur, you mentioned in the previous term, the chief secretary for administration could stand in as the CE. Is that right? Can you answer briefly, please? If the election proceedings are terminated for the next round of polling, there will be new nominations. So that the scenario mentioned by Mr. Yip Kin Yoon, the chances of that happening should be very, very low. To a certain extent, we'll say that that's just an academic point discussion.
I think there is a very slim chance of this happening. Mr. Ma Feng Kwok, first round, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. I don't know whether this has been asked by another member. Para 15, Para 17, 18, 23, and 25, you mentioned five times that the CE must get 600 votes before he can be returned. 601. But some election committee members, I think this happened in previous elections as well, they may have more than one place because one person can join the EC in different capacities. When you say 601 and you say it so many times in your paper, what would happen if one person occupies several seats on the election committee? Why don't you just say over half? How do you understand this? It's an important point. Chairman, regardless of the size of the resultant EC, the candidate must get 601 votes before he is returned. But what is your interpretation? How do you understand this? I think the law states this. The law states 601 votes or more before the candidate is returned. But then the composition of the EC is such that there will not be a total of 1,200 people. There will be fewer. So does the law says it, or should the criterion be over half of the membership? Chairman, the law states that there should be 601 votes or more. And it's true that the election committee may not be composed of 1,200 exactly. It did happen that some people joined in more than one capacity, and in the end, the election committee is of a smaller size than 1,200. But even so, the candidate must get 601 votes before he is returned. So it means the composition of the EC must be at 601 before for it to be effective. What if the EC is composed of fewer than 600 people? I mean, if that does happen. Undersecretary, Chairman, I don't think that is possible. The election committee has a membership of 1,200. I can't imagine how the membership
can shrink to 600 or fewer. I don't think that will happen. But in fact, in other places, this did happen, that the electors could not reach a certain number because of corruption, war, or other reasons. What if the electors do not add up to a certain number? Undersecretary, Chairman, I think this is an academic discussion. The law states that the candidate needs 601 votes. This is to ensure that the candidate so returned has broad support. If the election committee is fewer than 600, there can be no CE election. Last member, Ms. Lau Siu Lai, 2 minutes. I still like to ask about disqualification of candidates for the EC. Undersecretary, I know you answered the question many times, but we were asking you about the criteria for deciding the absence of a close connection. You only told us about the procedures, and I can see that it only says the RO has just to be satisfied whether there is a close connection, and you said there should be a legal opinion sought. We were not asking you about the procedures, but the criteria, say the close connection should be for a number of years, is that right? Or should he still be with the sector, or in order to establish a close connection? I believe you are disqualifying people who do not support CY Leung. Or is it that you are not satisfied with the qualification of students and frontline workers? You only support the rich and powerful. We are not asking you about the procedure, but the criteria, in other words, the yardstick to decide on disqualification. I think I have said many times, I think the yardstick is the law. The law doesn't say so much. It just says the RO has to be satisfied. So I want the RO to answer me. Should someone be away from the subsector for a certain period of time for him to still claim a close connection? I just want you to clarify that. The returning officer. Chairman. As I said, the term close connection is within the law. It is interpreted to guide the RO in making his decisions. As I said, normally he has to consider the composition of the subsector and the electorate base. And these vary for the subsectors according to law. So it depends on the individual cases and the subsector. There can be no general answer. No, you are beating about the bush. Yes, it says he should consider the composition of the subsector, but then the last word is that it is just for the RO to be satisfied. I think the question has been repeated. Do you want to supplement? No. What about the election officers? Any other questions? If there are none, AOB, the next meeting will be held on the 19th of December, a Monday, at 2:30. Anything under AOB? Nothing. The meeting is adjourned. Thank you.